Welcome to Swinger University, your horizontal enrichment program, offering you the naked facts about swinging. Here are your hosts, Ed and Phoebe.
Hi, this is Ed.
And this is Phoebe.
Today we're updating you on bacterial vaginosis, or BV. We have done more research on this important topic that seems to affect many women in the lifestyle. We'll be covering the following in this episode: defining BV, who and how people get BV, BV as an STI, vaginal pH, and a list of 32 items to limit your chances of getting BV.
But before we get started, Ed and I want to ask for your help. It's our desire to reach out to more people with our podcast, and here's how. Rate and review us on iTunes and Spotify. Mention Swinger University on social media. Tell your friends about our podcast. Follow us on Instagram, TikTok, and Twitter. You can find all the links to our social media in the show notes of this episode. We appreciate you and all the support you give to us and our podcast.
As a matter of fact, we got our first patron through Patreon.
Yes.
Special shout out to John and Angel for their support of our podcast. It's super exciting for us, and we're thinking of all the different things that we really should be doing for a sponsorship and how that should work for us. So we're working out details, and more will be coming as the days progress.
Exactly. As we mentioned earlier, we will be defining BV, who and how people get it, BV as an STI, vaginal pH, and those items of 32 items that can limit your chance of getting BV. So hang out to the end and or fast forward, but you're going to miss all the interesting stuff that's been updated in between. And trust me, I think I have done, oh my God, well over 20
hours.
Yeah. Well over 20 hours of research, just reading scientific journals, credible sources, not just women's health and men's health, you know, those types of fluff. Not that they're, you know, total fluff, but really diving into the articles and getting the meat and potatoes of it all.
Yeah, these weren't cosmopolitan articles that you were using. These were actual medical research. And we've been researching and having discussions with some of our nurse friends.
Absolutely.
Who are actual medical professionals.
And OBGYNs who we've met in the lifestyle, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah.
Right. So while we are not medical experts, and we're going to do our best to kind of convey this highly medically dense content, we're going to present it in a way that's, you know, not so convoluted or
I hope not technical. I hope not. It's very detailed. Put your detail hat on, get your pouch, pen, paper.
Yeah, and for, I mean, to kind of lead into this, we know a number of women who we have talked to over the last 6 months or a year who struggle, and I mean the level and depth of their suffering with BV they've considered getting out of the lifestyle as a direct result of it. So this is, for a lot of women, this is really a big pain in the hoo-ha.
Yes. All right. So what is BV? It's actually not classified as a sexually transmitted infection, or STI, according to Planned Parenthood. STIs are transmittable via skin-to-skin contact. According to the CDC, BV is caused by an imbalance of your natural microflora, especially in your gut, which I think also translates down into the vagina, and we'll get there to that point as well. According to the Mayo Clinic, there's a change of the bacteria found in your vagina upsetting that balance, which causes this imbalance is unknown. They're still researching it. It affects 30% of women in childbearing years and occurs in women of any age. It affects women in perimenopause and menopause. That sweet range of like 45 to 58, which is your prime swinger age, right? The kids are out of the nest. You've got some expendable income, you know.
Yeah. And if you listen to most accounts, most people start swinging maybe late 30s, but like the big slice of the pie is people who are in their, you know, early to late 40s and older.
Right. So this, you know, perimenopause and menopause, obviously there's a reduction of your hormones and your estrogen levels, and that can tend to kick off some of these imbalances in your vagina. BV is strongest after sex and menstruation due to the quick pH shift. This happens, for me personally, it happened on the cruise and at New Year's and at one of our other friends' party, because one, you're using somebody else's lube, somebody else's condom with spermicides. You're introducing latex with, maybe you have latex sensitivity, which throws stuff off. Did I already say you're using somebody else's lube?
Yeah.
That's going to throw that me off. You're in the hot tube too long, right? And you've got swinger soup. People have been in there all day long. Even though they change out the water at night, I mean, you got all day, people in the hot tub all day long. And those hot tubs are packed on the cruise. Packed.
We're actually just listening to Black and Kinky talking about their trip to Desire and the pool, the hot tub at the end of the evening just being human soup.
He swore he could see semen floating on the top. Yeah. Gross. So, hello. Yeah. 50 to 75% of women do not have symptoms, and 84% of women don't even recognize they have the symptoms. It's a low-grade occurrence. So you can have it, but not have the symptoms.
Right.
20 to 30% of the women get it again in 3 months, and 50% will get it again in a year. It can be passed from female to female via sexual intercourse and female to female via man. Monogamous relationships can break the cycle of sharing the bacteria between both partners by using condom for about 3 or 4 months. So, yeah.
So if you like playing with your partner without condoms, because, you know, we like to use condoms with our play partners, but I don't want to use them at home.
Yeah. Now, I will say, when I was researching this, I did find additional resources on the female to female via sexual intercourse. It's pretty difficult to actually pass that along. And it cannot be passed by skin-to-skin contact. You really... What happens really is there's just an imbalance. You've introduced enough random things into your vagina to upset your pH.
Okay.
One, like I said earlier, it's a spermicide on a condom, because you'd never use that with your spouse. Why? Because you don't need to use condoms. Two, you're using somebody else's lube, you know, at their house or in a playroom. Three, someone's got their fingers in 5 other women, and now they stuff their fingers in you. Well, that's like a multitude of bacteria that's all been transferred down the line over to you. If you're in an orgy situation, like we love, you've got oral, so you've got all the mouth bacteria.
Right.
You've been drinking, which upsets your pH. Maybe you're dehydrated. You've been in the pool. You've been in the hot tub. You sat in your, like, it's all those things that you wouldn't normally be doing that's gonna throw off your pH, and your vagina's gonna freak out. So there you go. It's super exciting. According to the CDC, the cause of microbial alteration that precipitates BV is not fully understood, and whether BV results from the acquisition of a singly transmitted pathogen is unknown. So they just haven't, the research isn't there.
Right.
There's no motivation, right?
Well, if you look at traditionally most of the research that's done, it's funded by men mm-hmm. for men, mm-hmm. and it's, they just don't think about women.
Right. And so, everything is, you know, what do we get out of it, right? So if they can get a drug or a pill out of it, sure, yeah, they'll fund it, but
right.
It's just a topic they haven't really, no one's really funded. BV is associated with having multiple male sexual partners, female partners, sexual relationships with more than one person, a new sex partner, lack of condom use, douching, and people with herpes simplex virus 2 or genital herpes.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you read through that laundry list of things, what you start to realize is swinger behavior, new sex partner. Yep. Swinger behavior.
Yes.
Okay. So lack of condom use, maybe, maybe not. Douching. Eh. People with herpes. Well, potentially.
Potential. More than 50% of the population has herpes.
It's very, very prevalent.
Yes. Very prevalent.
And speaking of, individuals who have HSV2 or herpes simplex virus 2 that have positive antibodies are asymptomatic individuals, no symptoms. They can have virus shedding, meaning they are actively contagious. So here's the thing, you don't have to have symptoms and you mm-hmm. could be actually shedding or transmitting that virus to other people, which is why when we've done research on HSV,
which we'll have another podcast on,
right, most people are actually walking around with HSV and just don't know that they have it. And
exactly.
Unless you take a specific antibody test, you don't know.
You don't know. Yeah, you really don't know. And there's a bunch of stigma around that, and we will definitely speak to that and you know what that means in the lifestyle.
And what it means in this particular episode is you've added a contributing factor to bacteria imbalance and basically
yes.
gives you a BV flare-up. So,
oh, so exciting.
Yeah.
What's important here is the majority of the population has herpes that doesn't know. We'd already stated that before. And you know, I think Ed already spoke to the other two line items that I was just going to read to you. So there you go.
I will edit that out. Okay.
According to Planned Parenthood, having sex with a new partner or multiple partners may increase your risk of BV. We kind of touched on that earlier. And sex sometimes leads to BV if your partner's natural genetic chemistry changes the imbalance of or the balance of your vagina and causes bacteria to grow. This happened to me when I would change sexual partners, boyfriend to boyfriend, you know, I left, broke up with a boyfriend, right?
Right.
Then I got into a new relationship. We decided to have sex without a condom, and his semen would set off a subtle, now I was young, so my body could kind of rebound quickly. And maybe I had BV, but I didn't have the level of symptoms that, you know, you can get, or most people get, or some people get. But I would notice a difference, right?
Right.
In odor. And I always knew that the new semen would set off my body, and after a while it would take my body to get used to it, and then I was fine.
Well, and the other thing to think about too is, you know, this is about genital chemistry. So any kind of chemical or mm-hmm. whether that's a biological chemical, in other words, you know, his hormones or secretions or natural pH or whatever on his cock. Mm. But it could also be the soap that he uses or the perfume, or if he's using Axe body spray, any kind of chemical that's being introduced into the vagina
will throw off. I didn't even think about that. The dryer sheets on his underwear that's all over his junk.
Antibacterial soap residue. I mean, there's so many things that we have introduced into our mm-hmm. our ecosystem, mm-hmm. our genital ecosystem, that can really fuck up the pH.
This is why I've just gone perfume-free everything, perfume-free soap, laundry, everything.
Yeah.
Everything. that the clothes are washing, the towels are washing, the pH, I use the pH balance soap.
Yeah.
All of it.
And that whole fresh forest scent that you put into your clothes may actually be creating a not so fresh forest scent in your crotch.
Can we call my squirting ocean spray now?
Ooh. Mm.
I'm going to ocean spray you. Do you mind?
Fresh mountain spring.
Ooh, mountain spring. I tend to mountain spring. Do you mind? Yeah, you know, that's, I might change it up.
100% organic.
Oh my goodness. But according to other resources, this BV cannot be passed via swimming pools or hot tubs, even if they have enough chemicals still left in them. However, depending on the length of time you're sitting in that damn hot tub, 3 hours at a time, over 5 to 7 days on a cruise, then probably your likelihood is going to be a lot higher.
Yeah, especially because, well, actually on the cruises they don't chlorinate, but
no,
at a lot of other places they do use chlorine still.
True.
And so that chlorinated water being in regular contact, and you know, you people are fingering each other in the hot tub.
Yeah.
So you're kind of pushing.
Or fucking in the pool.
No, nobody does that.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
That doesn't actually happen.
Oh.
But you're pushing that chlorinated water up inside, which is going to kill bacteria. That's what chlorine does. So it's killing the good bacteria.
Right. Like an antibiotic.
Right.
And it's irritating. It's irritating to the vagina. It's irritating to the skin around it. So it is important to shower and remove all that chlorinated water, pool clothing immediately when you get out of the water. You know, just don't go in the water with pool clothes. Just costumes, as they say in Australia.
Right.
Just go in naked and then just rinse off with soap when you're done.
Yeah. The other thing to think about too, when you are in a chlorinated pool and you are having sex or fat, you know, digital penetration, that water isn't particularly lubricated. It's kind of rough, right?
Yes.
That your natural lubrication washes off, and the rough texture will also affect the walls of the vagina and the pH, etc.
Yes.
So that irritation is bad too, which is also why lube and good lube is really important when you have sex, because that lubrication is kind of key.
Protects. Yeah, it's like the difference of rubbing sandpaper on your lips versus chapstick or Carmex or, yeah.
And for those people who argue that the silicone-based lubes do work in the pools, that's true. That will help. But it's still got chlorine, and so
you're
reducing one thing, but you're still introducing another.
But does
thing.
The silicone cover, like, protect? Probably not.
The skin and the surface, but probably not the bacteria, because that's different.
Okay, y'all, you test that out and you get back to us.
Right.
Some scientific studies are reporting Gardnerella vaginalis may be the main bacteria of the 4 or 5 others that you have in your vagina that, when out of balance, will result in BV. Gardnerella. That's it. Ed got it. Alone does not cause BV. Additionally, BV-associated bacteria can be identified on male genitalia. The treatment of male sex partners has not been beneficial in preventing the recurrence of BV. I'm not sure what treatment they were using, but what I found in the research was that really making sure that you're using a condom for, oh gosh, good three, four weeks. Yeah. Because you can tend to pass it back and forth. A little bit of it will live up there in the urethra, so.
Right. And it gives the time for the gentleman's natural biology to kill off the extra bacteria, get back into pH balance, get back into equilibrium before it gets reintroduced.
Exactly. All right. So as Ed was talking about pH balance, what the heck is it? It's important for a healthy vagina. Your vagina is an acidic environment, which is healthy and normal. The natural protection against the overabundance of an unhealthy bacteria and yeast, which can cause infections. So this nice acidic environment helps protect you. In fact, a very healthy pH vagina kind of smells like a little like blood, like a penny. For reference, the scale is 0 to 14. So if your pH is less than 7, it equals acidic. If it's more than 7, it's basic. Your vaginal pH, if you're in the age of 15 to 49, should be around 3.8 to 4.5. Your vaginal pH when you're menstruating should be around 7.4 because the blood changes your pH. It's important to change that pad and tampon frequently to reduce the contact of blood sitting in the vagina. So as you're aging and your body's changing and your hormones are changing, and you're going through perimenopause and you don't know when you're having a period and when you're not, you know, sometimes you may want to leave that tampon in for a little longer because you don't know what the fuck's going to happen because your body's not doing its normal cycle anymore. Don't leave that tampon in too long. You may want to switch over to a pad because you are going to mess up your pH by leaving that in there too long.
Right.
So I had to make some changes when my body was changing and my cycle was changing. Your vaginal pH after menopause is typically higher than 4.5. It's due to reduced estrogen. Your vaginal walls start to thin, which has less exfoliation. You have a little more dryness, and those pH levels rise, which makes you a little more susceptible to infections and inflammation. So just that process of going into perimenopause and menopause kind of
increases your risk.
It does. It really does. So how do you tell? How do you test this?
Amazon has the answer, of course, because yeah. There's everything on Amazon. So you can actually use pH strips. For those of you who did take chemistry in high school, they're small little paper strips. And with a swab, you can test the pH of a liquid. So it's pretty easy to test that. We'll have a link included for those pH testing strips. If you test yourself often, preferably after sex or after drinking or after your period, you kind of get an idea over time of how your body is changing and reacting to those different things being introduced.
Exactly. And it matters because there's discomfort or odor. And honestly, it does increase the risk of other STIs. So, you know, you just want to be mindful of that.
Right. That natural acidic nature of the vagina actually fights off infections and fights off other bacteria. So it's kind of important to maintain that natural
especially protection. For you barebackers out there.
Yes.
All right. How does your pH get out of whack? Diet, stress, swinger stress. You can have swinger stress. It's sometimes really stressful to go to these events, especially when you're new or when you're not new and you're going to a new venue. You know what the fuck to expect, right? It's a little stressful. Your hormones are out of whack, your gut health, your period, douching, antibiotics, unprotected sex with the semen, all that stuff we talked
and
about.
And antihistamines or allergy medicine will also throw off your moisture levels in those mucous membranes that you have, which will dry you out, which will also cause a shift in pH.
Yes, because moisture is your friend.
Moisture is everyone's friend.
The act of having sex will also lower it because your body wants to get pregnant. So as you have sex, your hormones start to change, the endorphins start to rise, your body starts to lower the pH because
it wants the sperm to get through.
Exactly.
And that's the whole thing. So that whole survival of the fittest thing that everybody talks about, the strongest sperm is the one that you want to get through to the egg. So...
Yeah.
The pH balance shifts just enough so that it doesn't kill all the sperm, but the strong ones will still get through, but it is shifting it.
Right. So, gosh, you know, when you think about it, like the pool, the condom, the others, the lube, the stress, the, like, all those unusual factors that you got going on a swinger cruise or a swinger hotel takeover, and then you're having lots of sex, or maybe you have sex once, like sometimes we find at a swinger takeover, which is so not right. It's enough factors lined up in a row, 10 factors almost, where your body's like, I give up. I can't handle. I can't deal.
Yep. The vagina throws in the white flag at about day 5 or day 3 of a 5-day cruise. And you're pretty much
you're done. And you can't be done. Like, no, you have more fucking to do. Semen also lowers the pH, makes it more alkaline. And so, okay, so how do I change it? This is like the million-dollar question. Diet, probiotics, medications, hormone replacement therapy, hydration, reduce your alcohol consumption, and I'm going to list some other things down below. And I've got some great links on probiotics. Lola makes one, and also Good Clean Love makes an insert, a vaginal insert, if you are actually having a BV flare-up. I've tried it. It works great. They also have a product that keeps your flora fauna in a healthy state. So, you know, say you, I don't know, did some extra drinking that weekend or had a little extra sex, use someone's lube by mistake. You're like, I just need a little backup plan. I'm going to put in some, you know, a little protective, a little extra moisture with some hyaluronic acid and the Good Clean Love Restore Balance thing. Good. All good. I tell you, I've experimented on myself so much. You will love it. You will love it.
And for those of you who had heard about our Costa Rica takeover in that last play session that we had, reduced alcohol consumption actually has other biological benefits, including reduction in lip swelling, groin and testicle swelling, from impact and high velocity, So, cutting down on the drinking is actually good for a whole bunch of reasons.
Yes, and hopefully not get the label of spider monkey of the playroom by the entire resort.
Yeah.
Vaginal microbiota. What the heck is that? Ed, please enlighten us.
Well, I'll put my lab coat on for this one.
Perfect.
Vaginal flora or vaginal microbiome are the microorganisms that colonize the vagina. So it's all of those good natural things that are keeping your body moving and fighting off infections.
Yep.
We have good bacteria in our body that helps our body to maintain our processes and keep things moving.
Mm-hmm.
Lactobacillus dominates and creates a protective environment. So everybody's seen the commercials about probiotics and, you know, you can get yogurt with it and all that kind of stuff. All of those things, whether you like it or not, we have bacteria that lives in our body that actually keeps us alive. It helps us to digest our food. It keeps our skin.
It lives on our skin.
Black, you know, fresh. Yep. It's good.
Mm-hmm. And if, you know, I'm out of balance, I'm going to have some discharge or odor or itching. You know you're out of balance because of all the things mostly that I listed earlier: perimenopause, menopause, birth control, menstruation, any shifting of hormones, your sexual activity, smoking, diet, stress, and antibiotics. What are the things we can do at home or at an event and location to limit your chance of getting BV?
Right. So this is the 20-part list of things you just shouldn't do or should do.
Yeah. And we're going to go through the at-home list.
Yeah.
First.
So first one, no douching. Like, never douche.
No,
period.
Never. No. It's just a marketing... I don't even know why. Because it's...
Somebody
it's
made
a money maker.
On it one time.
Use perfume-free detergent and fabric softener. Number three, perfume and antibacterial body wash and soaps. No, no, no. Number four, nylon underwear and tight yoga pants can block air movement and increase bacterial growth. So every time I exercise, I get it out of those shorts right away. I don't sit in that. I get out. I put on something dry, or I clean off the bacteria, and I literally, my OBGYN told me to put a hair dryer, use the hair dryer every time after I go to the bathroom to dry that environment.
And to be specific, to dry the vulva, the outer labia, and the outer parts of the vagina. So ladies, don't shove the hair dryer up your hoo-ha. That is not what we're
advocating. What if it's a really nice shape?
Leave it turned off and unplugged. But I don't recommend that. And by the way, this goes for men too. So we've been talking about bacteria being introduced into the vagina. Your shorts will also increase your bacteria in your junk. And if you're introducing that into her vagina, then you're also throwing things off. So let them breathe, gentlemen. Let them breathe.
Yeah. So what do you do at swinger events? I just learned you have a special strategy that I didn't even know about till like yesterday.
It's really, it's highly scientific.
Uh-huh.
And I spent a lot of time thinking about this.
Uh-huh.
It's great. There's a lot of side benefits to it as well.
Mm-hmm.
I don't wear underwear.
Wait, what? Say that again.
I don't wear underwear. I just let them hang.
Never, ever to an event.
No, why? Either I'm wearing a kilt and letting things just be natural.
Uh-huh.
Or I'm not wearing underwear. Because I've found even with cotton underwear, basically I'm pressing the cock up against the balls and pushing all of that up against my body. I sweat. And
right.
Most ladies don't want to put that in their mouth.
Right. Right.
So.
Right. You let the air
go. Let the air circulate.
There's no sweating.
Right.
That makes sense. It's kind of like under boob sweat, but it's cock and ball sweat.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I'm not wearing underwear right now.
What?
It's summertime.
Change your underwear or panty liner several times a day. Change out of your wet clothing quickly, especially if you're sweating or, you know, like the swimsuits. Install, this is number seven, install a bidet on your toilet. You can get that on Amazon for like $50. It's an add-on. We got one. I freaking love that thing.
I love that thing.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
At first, it took me a little bit to get used to, but now... love it.
And I'll say it's the one that we got isn't a heated one. It's cold water, but you kind of get used to that, and it's actually not so bad. It's kind of refreshing. It's a little brisk at first, but especially in winter.
Uh-huh.
But it's not so bad. Now, if you've got hot water, like if your toilet's next to your sink, you can tap into the warm water.
Yes.
But even with that, like, I'd be a little concerned about getting straight hot water from the tap and spraying it up to your...
it's got to be mixed just right, I'm sure.
Right.
We were going to try that, but the logistics of the bathroom wouldn't allow for that. So, yeah, there you go.
Not till the remodel.
But it is amazing for washing off after sex or, you know, or a quick workout. Say you can't jump in the shower right away because Ed's making me dinner and all I have to do, you know, I've just done a workout. I just... hop on the bidet, rinse off, and I'm good to go for a little while. I already talked about the hairdryer. That was number eight. I already talked about nylon underwear and tight yoga pants. That was number nine. 10. Don't use lube that's expired, dude. Like, read that label. It does go bad.
The important lesson there is to use all the lube up. So have sex as often as you can.
There you go.
Make sure that you don't waste lube because it's important to conserve.
Yeah. don't waste that money. Have more sex.
Yeah.
That's it. Exactly. Use a lube that dispenses without touching your fingertips.
Right. So the pump bottle that you don't have to like get your fingers all in it. If you're dipping your fingers into a bucket of stuff.
Yeah, not good.
Yeah, that's not good. So those people who really like coconut oil, there's another reason why you don't dip your fingers in the lube.
So even our squirt bottle, the Good Clean Love or the Lola. The Lola, I think, has a pump. The Good Clean Love comes out of a little squirt bottle. You just squirt it down into your hand. You don't like wipe your hand across the top.
Right.
So just, you know, think about germs. Limit amount of sperm in your vagina, especially if you're, you know, you're at a swinger event and you want to fuck a bunch of people. Just tell your man, hey, you know, just maybe for the trip, just come outside me. Or come inside me twice this trip or something. You know, just be gentle.
So Phoebe is actually advocating for pearl necklaces, facials, yes. Swallowing. It's an important exercise to reduce your chances of BV.
Right. So you can continue to have sex with other people.
Right.
See? These are good strategies.
Right. So swallowing is biologically important.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
It's not only good for your skin.
It's good for your vagina. I do like rubbing it all over me, and especially on my breasts. It's very silky.
I love watching you rub it all over.
Condoms only you and your partner have tested as a no trigger condom. That's number 13. So use your own shit. What?
And to be specific, that's condoms that you know are safe for you, not the random
in the playroom
Chinese who knows where they came from and what spermicide is on them kind of a condom,
colored or glowed or flavored.
So stick with the good condoms that you know where they came from, the Skins, the Lilos,
the
Magnums, Trojans, also good as long as it's not a spermicidal condom, etc.
Exactly. Abstain from sex if you have BV. You and your partner will continue to pass it back and forth, and you can, and it, I already said it can temporarily live in the urethra. 15, boric acid suppositories. They do seem to help with staying fresh. I have used those. 16, drink more water. 17, use some probiotics. I already talked about Lola has one, and then Good Clean Love has an insert. It's called BioFresh. It's like a it's called BioFresh homeopathic vaginal suppository.
And the BioFresh isn't FRESH. It's PH.
Yes.
Like fat.
Exactly.
Fresh.
Very clever of their marketing. You can also try Lume deodorant. That's Lume. It is aluminum and baking soda and paraben free, and it goes anywhere bacteria loves to live. So I love this as I'll rub it on my vulva and down around the backside when I know I'm gonna be at a party with I don't have any underwear on. Oh my god, yes, I don't wear underwear to parties.
Doesn't wear underwear either.
Sometimes if it's a dress that I don't want panty lines, I just don't wear underwear.
Or you really want those sparkles to show through when you wear the sparkly panties.
Yes.
But yes.
But I don't want to be, you know, what if I'm going from the dance floor to the playroom? I don't have time to like really go wash up all the way back to the hotel room or the bathroom. So I want to be fresh and clean, and I don't want to be sweaty, and I don't want bacteria down there. So Lume deodorant, you can rub on down there, and it keeps you totally fresh. It doesn't taste like anything. It doesn't change the pH. It's amazing.
And you're describing rubbing it onto your vulva, but you're talking about the kind of the outer parts.
Yes.
Kind of not even on the lips per se, but maybe like on the sides. I just want to understand where I'm rubbing.
No. Oh.
Where do I need to rub?
Yes. So I rub it on the sides, and I rub it on the outer labia.
Okay.
And then down below, in between, what do you call that? The perineum?
The taint.
That's for you. I think mine's called the perineum.
It's all the perineum. But the, it taints your pussy and it taints your
butt. Back around the asshole. Like, because sweat gets back there too. And who wants to be smelly back there?
She fingers her pucker.
I don't. And nobody else better. Because I don't like that.
You just prefer to cock.
Yes. To stick. Don't
Quit
stick a tongue.
Quit teasing you with a finger and a tongue. Just no, give me the.
Yes. No tongue, no finger. That's just weird. It teases me. I don't know. I don't like it. Just give me the
go
cock.
Bigger.
Exactly.
Don't go.
Exactly.
There
That's
she,
it.
There you go. There's
I
Phoebe.
Love it. I'm not kidding. I do.
She's not.
I know.
She's,
I'm saying that for them.
She's dead serious.
I am dead serious. Okay. Number 20, hormone changes. The estrogen. So bum. I said before, birth control. You're getting older. There's a little more dryness. Estrogen is a lubricator. So as you get older and you age and, you know, la, 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 your estrogen is, you know,
you stop
stopping,
producing.
Yeah. Right? Basically. So it's going to affect lubrication. And so I would consider hormone replacement therapy. I've done, oh my God, so much research on this, you guys. I can't wait to tell you about this topic. I have interviewed 8 or 9 doctors. I'm switching to another doctor because I tried one doctor. I'm firing him. Now I'm on to another doctor and I'm reading this really good book. So like tune in because I can't wait.
It's a thing. It's legit.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
And to be clear too, hormone replacement therapy is not your mother's hormone replacement therapy.
No.
There have been so many advances with science.
Right.
We love science.
Yes. And I am, and specifically bioidentical hormone replacement therapy.
Right.
Probably not the standard hormone replacement therapy from your OBGYN, because they are first and foremost a surgeon and they really don't have time to dedicate the amount of research to proper hormone replacement therapy, more of which I will go into in another episode. Number 21. Ed already spoke about it. Regular use of allergy or medicines that have a drying effect on your mucous membranes. The vagina's best defense, internal moisture and pH balance.
There you go.
All right. We got through those 21. Swinging location. Go
for
it.
Yeah. What do you do when you're at an event?
So talk about what the 12 things you can do while you're swinging at a location. And then once we get through the 12, we are wrapping this.
My new personal favorite, reduce your alcohol consumption. Please reduce your alcohol consumption.
Save Ed. It's the civil GoFundMe. Save the Ed Fund.
Save the Ed Fund. Changes your blood pH and it will also dehydrate you, which is pretty key to keeping your body functioning normally. Mm-hmm. Dehydration's bad.
Number 2.
Condoms. Use latex-free condoms.
Yep.
We've switched
and
use pretty much latex-free condoms for two reasons. One, I don't have to carry two types of condoms in case I encounter a lady who is latex sensitive. I don't have to think about it. I don't have to look for the right thing in the bag. I just grab a condom.
Right.
It's always latex-free.
And they don't taste bad. So we've had a couple soft swap situations where they don't want to have oral without a condom, and the latex free taste great. They don't have the rubber taste.
Yeah. Less of that Goodyear taste.
Yes.
Condoms without spermicide. So please, no matter what, you probably shouldn't be using spermicidal condoms anyway. They're really not good for use on a regular basis, especially in the lifestyle.
Number 4.
Condoms over your fingers before finger play. So we've talked about doing this. We haven't actually implemented this plan. We have condoms specifically for this.
We did a few times about 5-6 years ago when I was having some issues, but then I found some other techniques that worked.
But if you are having issues, condoms over your fingers can help.
And ladies, this is kind of cool because here's the other technique I use. So if I'm in an orgy situation and I see a guy just fingering another woman and he wants to come over and we're kissing and making out and his hand starts to move down there, I said, I'm happy if you finger me, but I just ask, you know, could you just please wash up at the sink before? Yeah. Cool. And he's happy to go over there and do it. I just found that's easier to say rather than put on a condom. It just helps reduce some of the bacteria transfer from person to person.
Yeah. You can restrict your oral play, especially in oral situations. That's also another reason why mouthwash is kind of handy to have in a playroom. So if you're going to set up a party, having mouthwash in the bathrooms helps to kind of clean out some of those bacteria that are in your mouth. And use water-based lube. So oil-based lubes, not so good. Glycerin-based lube. So those are water-based, but they got a lot of sugar in them.
A lot of sugar.
That's really bad for growing bacteria. Bacteria love sugar.
Oh, hell yeah.
And all the bacteria, including the bad bacteria, like it. So it's not good. It'll throw everything off.
Number 7.
No coconut oil. So those of you who believe that coconut oil is good, it is not.
It's not.
Don't put it in your hoo-ha. We have a lube episode. We really recommend that you go back and listen to that because we talk about coconut oil and the evils of coconut oil. Limit your hot tub time at parties. So chemicals are an irritant, throws your chemical balance off, and
the filters might not be clean.
Yeah, the filters and the water are probably not clean. Limit your pool time in very dense people to water ratio. So swinger soup.
Yep,
that bacteria is swimming around, and guess what? It's going up inside you. Limit your time in wet clothing. So change out of your wet clothes. Dry yourself off. Get the chlorine off of your body. That's your gym clothes and your swimsuits. Use HybaCleanse soap when washing hands before play. Now, there's some pros and cons with this. HybaCleanse is a very bacterially caustic substance.
Yes.
It kills bacteria. They use it for, you know, cleansing wounds
and in the operating room go in. Yeah.
But here's the problem. It has a residue and a lifespan to it. So even if you rinse it off, it doesn't all come off. Mm-hmm. So it's really, really strong. They don't want bacteria getting into a wound during surgery.
Right,
It's really bad.
So if you've washed your hands with HybaCleanse and then you've inserted your hands into a woman, you are potentially
killing all the good bacteria.
Killing her good bacteria. So, you know, just careful.
Yeah, HybaCleanse is kind of maybe a little bit like a flamethrower to kill a gnat.
Right.
A good soap and the birthday song is probably sufficient.
Yeah. I like that. Yeah.
Carry pH balanced wipes to clean up after play. So Lola makes some and Good Clean Love does. And that what that does is it cleans the vulva. It gets the bacteria away. So when you do put your panties on to leave the playroom, you're not smashing all of that outer juicy stuff back into the juicy middle.
Assuming you came with panties. Yeah.
That's true.
And I always reference Lola and Good Clean Love because I've tried their products extensively. I haven't tried anybody else's, probably because there really aren't that many on the market that are that friendly, women friendly. And I like these companies because I know Good Clean Love is a woman-owned company. We don't get any kickbacks or anything for it. I just love the product.
We love their products,
and I love everything about them, and they've worked so well for me. I'm excited to share it.
Yeah, and I would say your standard baby wipes may or may not work.
I tried those for a while.
There's a lot of scents in them.
Mm-hmm. They're not pH balanced.
They're not pH balanced.
And
they're not. They're typically designed to wipe poop off of babies' butts, so it's not the same kind of thing. It's. You know what? Your parts are a little bit more delicate. Spend for the extra stuff.
Yeah.
Get out of the baby section. Get into the adult section and have a little bit better luck with your vaginal health.
So we're going to post a bunch of this, the list online, and the plethora of links that we have for your own research.
Oodles
and snoodles of it. And you can dive in depth on that. You know, on this topic on your own if you'd like. But in closing, it comes down to being aware and modifying your self-care. If you struggle with bacteria vaginosis and getting rid of it. Just know you can still engage in the lifestyle and have a good time. It just may take a little strategy and implementation of a few key changes.
The Swinger University needs your help. If you like our podcast, let the world know, or at least tell a fellow swinger or two. Not only will you be helping us, you'll be helping your fellow swing lifestylers. Please rate and review us on Apple, Google, and Amazon podcasts. You can share your favorite episodes on social media. We're at TikTok at Swinger University, Twitter and Instagram at SwingU Podcast. Email us at swingeruniversity@gmail.com and visit our website at swingeruniversity.com, where you can find more information as well as visit our affiliates page to get a free 30-day membership at cassidy.com. Thank you for listening to Swinger University, your horizontal enrichment podcast.